We've been talking about relevance, and indeed in the early 21st century, there is no more relevant field of study, or no field that carries more implications and importance to us than the study of the studies that our next speaker has undertaken. Danielle Hawk works on the construction of Arab identity in the United States and its relationship to U.S. fantasies of the West and East, and on discourses of imperialism. So it doesn't get any more relevant than that. She is a assistant professor of English at Minnesota State University, and she is drawing on a range of sources for this presentation: advertisements, newspaper reviews, dime novel covers that feature the Arab and Arab American performers of Buffalo Bill's Wild West. And so we will now hear Danielle Hawk speaking on Arab performers and the Wild West.
Goes much lower for me. I first want to say I was fortunate enough to be a fellow here at the Buffalo Bill Center of the West this past year. And I want to thank Jeremy, Deborah, Linda, Sam, Mary, and all of the librarians who were extremely generous with their time. I basically came in to the Center of the West and said, you have all these haystacks. I need some help finding needles. And they did, they helped me. I also researched at the Denver Public Library and the Buffalo Bill Museum and Grave, so I also need to thank Steve Friesen and Kellen Cutsforth for their help. Okay, in 1893, Chicago hosted the World's Fair, or World's Columbian Exposition. Camped right outside the gates of the Columbian Exposition, Buffalo Bill's show advertised in the Rand McNally Official Guide to the Fair, stating that, quote, all roads lead to Buffalo Bill's Wild West. The Chicago Fair featured the first appearance of a new act in Buffalo Bill's Wild West, an Arab troupe, or at least this is the first time they show up in a program. That very same Rand McNally advert boasted that the show now had, quote, genuine Arabs of the desert. The Arab troupe performed with the Wild West for more than 20 years. In the 1899 Root Book, the Arabs are described as performing a show in which they, quote, illustrated their style of horsemanship together with native sports and pastimes. There is substantial scholarship on how the Wild West showcased the settler-colonial relationship between Native Americans and European Americans and helped create the popular images that mainstream America has about the American West and Native Americans. However, there's been very little writing about the Arab performers in the show, particularly as the historical records for the non-Native American performers is sparse. My larger research project seeks to address the absence of a historical narrative about the role of the Arab performers in the show. So utilizing archival materials from and about Buffalo Bill's Wild West, I analyze how the show and its actors labored to create and contest the popular image of the Arab in the United States. I argue, using historical accounts of the encounter between early Arab migrants and the unique racial configurations of the United States, that these performances and accompanying material culture demonstrate a shift in popular perceptions of, quote, Arabness, citizenship, and race. I examine European colonial adventure stories from North Africa and the Middle East in conjunction with early American captivity and frontier narratives. During today's presentation, I'm going to introduce some archival materials, and I try to give a wide range of materials in terms of type and chronology from the Buffalo Bill Center of the West and from the Buffalo Bill Museum and Grave. But what I'm really going to do today is make a case for thinking differently about the Arab performers in the Wild West, and to give you the historical and cultural context that informs my methodology for analyzing these materials. Scholars such as Joy Kasson, Louis Warren, and L.G. Moses have established Buffalo Bill Cody and his show as a significant architect of the national mythology of the Wild West and the Great Plains. The shows were not, however, only about reinforcing the moral certainty of expansion. Cody's show, as Kasson writes, quote, makes frontier life inseparable from its embodiment as spectacle. What, then, were troops of Arab acrobats and horsemen doing in a show premised on enacting national nostalgia for the Wild West? How did fantasies of the Orient contribute to and intersect with exhibitions of American nationalism as predicated on founding mythologies of frontiersmen, cowboys, and pioneers. According to Sarah Blackstone, only four full rosters have been identified and are from the years 1896, 1899, 1902, and 1911. These rosters demonstrate that over the course of the Wild West, at the very least, 40 individuals performed in the Arab troupe with the Wild West. It's unclear exactly how the Arab performers came to join the show. However, it seems likely that either Major John Burke brought them aboard as he had previous experience managing touring Arab performers, or that an Arab troupe that visited the show in Paris in 1887 may have inspired Nate Salsbury. It's worthwhile to note here that Arab performers, particularly Moroccans, were performing in acrobatic shows in London since at least 1840. It may be a way that European and European discourses of Orientalism seeped into the show during its tours abroad, and Arab acrobats were already performing on the US Eastern seaboard. Yet the Arab troupe didn't perform in isolation. And as Susan Collins shows, there's a long history of writers, politicians, and artists, such as Mark Twain, Theodore Roosevelt, Owen Wister, Frederick Remington, and Carl May, using their experiences in the Middle East to formulate ideas of the American West. She demonstrates that the US West has frequently been described as and likened to the spaces of the Middle East. And other examples abound. At the turn of the century, the US Department of Agriculture sent David Fairchild to the Iraqi region in search of plants to be productive in the West. It's also true that British hydrologists and US archaeologists from the University of Chicago and the University of Pennsylvania during this time, writing about their archaeological digs and about their other kinds of water engineering projects, used the West to sort of describe what they were doing in the Middle East. So not only were these landscapes juxtaposed, but their inhabitants as well. Stephen Saleta demonstrates how 19th century Zionists and mid-20th century politicians used US rhetoric about Native Americans to justify occupation in Palestine. Juxtaposing vanishing Indians and nomadic Bedouins implies that they share not only a common nature, but a common future. Their way of life is constructed, commodified, and showcased for consumption before they're going to be swallowed up by modernity. Undoubtedly, the decision to include Arabs was based on increasing attendance and in expanding the show's already existent non-Western part, which by 1893 already included Cossacks and Gauchos. The trend of internationalizing a show that began as a demonstration of American conquest of the West was directly in line with American foreign policy at the time, which had been expansionist overseas in the early part of the 19th century and reached a forceful halt during the Civil War and Reconstruction. By the 1890s, however, American industry, trade, and cultural production were expanding globally at unprecedented rates. Buffalo Bill's Wild West promoted the ideal of an expanding America, both domestically and globally. Robert Rydell and Rob Crows describe the show's excursions overseas and the inclusion of the Congress of Rough Riders of the world as transforming a drama about American civilization's triumph over the American West and its indigenous peoples into a drama replayed writ large as a triumph that would include the entire world. The late 1800s and early 1900s saw increasing migration to the United States from the area known as Greater Syria, which was then part of the Ottoman Empire and had been since the 16th century. While many of these immigrants spoke Arabic, these early immigrants did not necessarily identify as Arabs. The Ottoman Empire was the dominant power in the Middle East during the late 19th century, and nearly all of the immigrants from the Middle East came with passports and identification papers issued by the Ottoman Empire. The terms Turk and Syrian were used interchangeably, including on port of entry records. As a result, the immigration figures from the Middle East for that period are not particularly accurate, as Armenians, Turks, and Arabs were all identified as subjects of the Ottoman Empire. When the Ottoman Empire collapsed, most Arab immigrants began to identify with the region in the Ottoman Empire from which they came, usually Syria or Lebanon. Further complications as to the nominal nationalities of these immigrants come from the use of the word Syria. Before 1920, which could apply to the countries of modern Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, and Israel-Palestine. Although the earliest troop members in the Wild West claimed to be and were described in many of the programs as being Moroccan, my research shows that the majority of the later members were from Syria, Lebanon, and I know this from tracing their names through Ellis Island and through other ports of entry. And here you have an example of the Arabatic troop. This is George Hamid over here as a child, his uncle Abu Hamid, some of the most famous of the performers in the troop. And their costumes are the Ottoman flag, right? Before its collapse in World War I, the Ottoman Empire was consciously working globally to promote an image of itself as a modern European nation. The Ottoman state did this in many ways, including through art, by creating the Imperial Ottoman Museum, and regulating and curating an image of its past to portray itself as a modern member of the family of nations. The Ottoman state also did so by hosting pavilions at international fairs, such as the 1893 Columbian Exposition that I mentioned at the beginning of this paper. These pavilions presented the Arab periphery of the Ottoman Empire as a people, territory, in need of civilizing, in many ways paralleling how Americans at the time perceived the Native American population. The comparison was not lost on the Ottoman people, and one Ottoman poet, Zaya Golkap, wrote during the period that he hoped his homeland would become, quote, the free and progressive America of the East. Notably, although the Arab troop is often pictured as part of the far eastern portion of the show, parading in with elephants and camels among a host of eastern and African caricatures, they're also often associated with the Rough Riders and Native Americans. A 1909 program for the Wild West describes the show as including an arena in which, quote, the onlooker witnesses various exhibitions of horsemanship, wherein the dusky-skinned Arabian vies with the American cowboy in displays of equestrian expertness. The camp life of the Native American Indian is shown in contrast to the nomadic domiciles of the desert-born Bedouin. And as we see with these dime novel covers, vice versa. Here, American Indians are dancing dervishes and red Bedouins. So you have the Bedouins of the Plains, Buffalo Bill and the Red Bedouins. And you have the raid of the dancing dervishes and the snake master from Timbuktu. While these dime novels were not produced by the show, they reveal another layer of juxtaposition between Native Americans and Arabs in popular images of the West. The Native Americans and Arab performers are portrayed relatedly as nomadic, somehow unattached to the national landscape while being naturally attuned to it, and as a pre-modern culture and people disappearing from the modern nation state. In the show, the Arab contingent performed multiple roles. In the 1898 program, the Arabs are listed as participating in the Grand Review. Their featured act was called, quote, a group of Riffian Arabian horsemen, as well as participating in the Race of Races. A 1904 program lists the Arabs as participating in feats of horsemanship as well, but that was their secondary performance skill. Originally, the Arab performers were acrobats. The Rough Rider Annual of 1902 describes the Arabs as, quote, athletic gymnasts of a strange kind. It would repay a journey across the great desert to see. The Arab tumblers twirled rifles so quickly they looked like, quote, a thousand sunbeams. The acrobats built, quote, high living pyramids with the agility of cats and the strength of tigers. The Arabs were able to showcase their athleticism and thespian talents in a feature called, quote, The Far East or A Dream of the Orient. This feature combined a storyline that begins with a group of Western tourists being taken hostage by a tribe of Bedouin under the very shadow of the Egyptian pyramids, with exotic animals and music, as well as Japanese acrobats and other non-white performers who are able to showcase their skills within this Arabian frame story. However, unlike many of the vignettes that featured Native Americans, the white American actors were never really under threat of physical harm. Instead, they are entertained by music, menagerie, and performances. At the end, there is no charge of white masculine power to rescue them. Rather, the ransom money arrives and the hostages are freed. This moment also highlights the intricacies of US racial metrics in performance. These performances draw on colonial tales of the Orient, yet they also share the stage with reenactments of Indian conquest and captivity narratives. And it's worth noting that there are several newspaper reviews that describe visiting Bedouin tent camps, like within the Wild West, just as they visited Native American examples of this is the authentic way of Native American life. You could visit Arabs as well in their tents to experience their authentic way of life. The newspaper reviews usually talked about being served tea, being seen veiled women that the men refused to unveil, and these sorts of things. Posters and root books describe the show as featuring Riffian Arabs, Berbers, Syrians, Bedouins, Moroccans, whirling dervishes, and Moorish horsemen, regardless of the makeup of the group of the time. Even though these early immigrants from Greater Syria did not think of themselves necessarily as Arab, this period saw a legal and cultural consolidation of disparate groups under an Arab identity. The construction of a white legal identity for Arab immigrants has a long history in the United States. Early in US history, lawmakers start trying to figure out exactly how to categorize Arab Americans. For example, in the late 18th century, the South Carolina House of Representatives decided that Moroccan Arabs living in the state should be treated according to the laws for whites and not for blacks from Africa. Cody's period saw Supreme Court cases taking up questions of whiteness and citizenship, including the 1914 case of Dow versus the United States, one of the racial prerequisite cases in which the court worked through scientific evidence, scientific in quotes, of race and appeals to common knowledge in order to construct a legal definition of whiteness. So in this case, a Syrian immigrant, George Dow, had been denied citizenship on account of his race as Arab. The Syrian community mobilized because they knew that this was a future threat for their entire community. So Dow's legal counsel presented the court with the argument that if Jesus Christ, so it's coming back to Jesus again. If Jesus Christ was Semitic, he would have been allowed into the country, and therefore they also should be allowed into the country. And ultimately, this case represented the reconceptualization of race and what could be described in the worlds of Nell Painter as a, quote, enlargement of American whiteness. So in overturning the lower court's decision to deny George Dow citizenship on the grounds that Syrians should be classed as white persons, this represents a moment in which Christianity is mapped onto race and onto citizenship. However, this complex legal history is not reflected in popular representations of Arabs as embodied by advertisements from the Wild West. Rather, shows such as Cody's demonstrate how disparate groups were grafted onto one another through the development of shows, circus acts, and vaudeville over the course of the late 19th and early 20th century, as racial metrics began to concretize and as the courts codified them. What were traveling groups of acrobats importing tumbling skills learned in their homelands became Bedouin horsemen of the desert, importing instead opportunities to glimpse authentic and naturalized Arabs. Popular conceptions of Arabs are represented in these advertisements, but the supposedly ephemeral labor of performance also embodies these larger structures. I'm interested then in not only how the Arabs were represented, but how and what they performed. Susan Nance and Linda Jacobs both write about Arab performers in circuses and vaudevilles during this period, and Susan Nance actually writes a little bit about the Wild West as well, calling these performances, quote, pretending to be Arab and, quote, playing Eastern. The performances exemplify Edward Said's discourse on Orientalism. Arabness in this sense is a manner of dressing and acting. It is mimicry with no antecedent, as it only comes into being through imitation of an imagined essence. Said draws on a long history of 18th and 19th century British and French discourses that create and sustain the idea of the Orient. For example, the most famous of the Arab performers, George Hamid, wrote a wry memoir entitled Boy Acrobat, which is not entirely reliable, first published in 1956 about his time performing with Cody's Wild West and multiple circuses and burlesques. George Hamid's memoir demonstrates that the acrobats and horsemen performed Arabness, or as Linda Jacobs and Susan Nance say, played Eastern or pretended to be Arabs, within a complex matrix of racial hierarchies. Hamid's first encounter with the troupe also underscores Arabness as an embodied form of labor and an invented type. So after a difficult journey from Beirut at age 11, Hamid finally encounters the troupe he's meeting in France. He runs towards, quote, two men in Arab costume, only to find, quote, sprinkled among the Arabian Arabs were two Irish Arabs and a Jewish Arab. He also writes of how these natural horsemen only learned to ride upon joining the show, and how he identified as Lebanese and not as Arab. In my extended article, I work more completely through the relationship of Arabness to late 19th and early 20th century U.S. racial discourses, including pseudoscience and legal designations. It's also interesting to note that George Hamid writes about his acrobatic troupe after leaving the Wild West appears alongside minstrel shows as well. But I also talk more about its relationship to European discourses of Orientalism. So here's the troupe parading in Europe, where they would have been perceived very differently than the U.S., particularly when touring in France, because of the fact that the French had been in North Africa since the 1830s. So I've only begun to touch on the archival materials here and the connections I'm making between histories that are often read in isolation. Connections, as Susan Collin points out, that continue to reverberate in our foreign policy. For as stories of the East helped America understand her relationship to the West, the Western has become the mode for justifying and narrating contemporary invasions and occupations of Iraq and Afghanistan and the War on Terror. From 1893 until 1913, Arab performers worked, traveled, and lived with Buffalo Bill's Wild West. Their inclusion in the show mirrored the increasing American interest in the Middle East as the United States strove to compete with entrenched European interests in politics, trade, and massive infrastructure railway projects like the Chester Project. The Arab performers also mirrored the growing Arab immigration to the United States, which happened both in major cities like New York City and Detroit, as well as small rural areas like Minnesota and North Dakota. The performers, as seen in advertisements and newspaper reviews of the show, are often represented as and performed stereotypes of Arabness for their audiences. Yet their inclusion in the show and exposure to large audiences across the United States also points to the long, vibrant history of Arab and Arab Americans participating in and shaping American culture. In her talk, if we can remember back to 2 days ago, Patricia Limerick asked us to rethink what Buffalo Bill studies could do to help us understand different histories and even reframe contemporary events. Her words speak to my goal for this project, which is to more fully explore and eventually include Arab American experiences in the story of the West and how we imagine it. Thank you.